Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Adrita Jaffrey and I'm a consultant orthodontist, and in this video tutorial I will be talking about different growth theories, and categorically my focus would be on the functional matrix theory. And before diving into the full details of the theory, I need to clear two very important points. One is there is a huge difference between a proposed theory and a scientific fact. There have been so many theories have been proposed about the growth and development, but please understand these are just the theories. According to those biologists, they say that the primary determinant of the growth is basically because of the suture or cartilage or remodeling or genetic picker, but this is not the scientific fact. Please do not confuse it with the proposed theory and a scientific paper. But second, one very important concept which should be very nicely understood is the concept of the growth site and growth center. Growth site is basically the area in the orofacial region where just the growth is occurring. However, the growth center is a position which has the genetic potential, and this has got the tissue separating forces, and the growth on the growth center is basically not determined by the surrounding variables or anything else. The proposed theories for the growth and development, all of them are saying that according to those theories that the growth center is basically this particular area. For example, the sutural theory which has been proposed, they're saying that the sutures are basically the growth center, and they start believing that the growth is occurring on the sutures, and start believing that the growth the sutures are basically the growth centers where the growth is occurring independent of anything else, and this has got the tissue separating forces, and it is genetically determined, and it has got the intrinsic growth potential. This is the proposed theory. However, this is the wrong. Similarly, the cartilages theory says, they say that growth center is basically the cartilages, and the growth of the orofacial region is basically occurring from the cartilages. He says that the cartilages of the orofacial region, for example, in the synchondrosis, in the maxilla, the nasal septum, and in the mandible, the condyle cartilage, they start believing that the growth is occurring on the cartilages, and cartilage has got the intrinsic genetically determined growth potential. Because of this, the growth is occurring. However, this is not the scientific fact. The actual fact is all about the functional matrix. This is a scientifically proven theory. So let's talk about the functional matrix theory. The functional matrix theory basically says that the growth is occurring in the soft tissue, and the soft tissue is determining the position and the morphology of the bone. So bone is a secondary role, the soft tissue has a primary role. The genes are expressing on the soft tissue. The soft tissue and the behavior of the soft tissue is basically determining the form, position, shape, and morphology of the skeletal hard tissue. This is basically the concept of the functional matrix theory. This is exactly just like this. For example, if you go to a gym and you start doing exercises, then what you see that your muscles are growing, and you will see that the bone is getting stronger. So what is happening, because of the increased functional, because of the change in environment, the soft tissue is behaving slightly differently, and as a response to the different functionality of muscles around it, the bone has start remodeling, and it's start behaving differently. So this is the same concept of the functional matrix theory. This theory basically says that the soft tissue basically grow, and as a response to the soft tissue, the bone behave secondarily, and it in the position, shape, and everything is basically determined on by the behavior of the soft tissue. The definition is that the origin, form, position, growth, and maintenance of all the skeletal tissue and organs are always secondary. The growth of the soft tissue of the skeletal tissue is basically secondary and compensatory and necessary response to the chronological and morphological prior event processes that occur in the specifically related to non-skeletal tissue. In simple word, the point is this, that the first the soft tissue grow, and in response to the soft tissue growth and in response to the functional need of the surrounding soft tissue, the skeletal growth is basically secondary, and all the growth of the skeletal tissue is basically determined by the soft tissue around it. Coming to the orofacial region, according to this theory, neither the cartilage of the condyle nor the nasal septum cartilage is determinant of the jaw growth. The jaw growth, the growth of the face occur as a response to the functional need and neurotrophic influences which is mediated by the soft tissue. Okay, so the major determinant of the growth of maxilla and mandible is the enlargement of the nasal and oral cavity, which grow in response to the functional need. The Prophet book has given many examples. The first example they have given about the brain. What happened? The brain basically enlarged in the size, and the cranium, which is surrounding the brain, increase in the size as a response and as a secondary response to the growth of the brain. The brain increase in the size, and the parietal bone, occipital and other bones, they start separating from each other because of the growth of the brain. So what happened? The growth start occurring on the margins and corner of the bone so that they can meet. If you have the microcephaly, microcephaly is some kind of feature in which you have the size of the brain is small. The growth of the brain is not occurring properly. Then did not be having a separating force on the cranial bones. That's why you would be observing a small size of the cranium. The second example is of the hydrocephaly. In the hydrocephaly, you have the problem of the absorption of the cerebrospinal fluid. So cerebrospinal fluid is basically not being absorbed, and it is increasing the intracranial pressure. Because of the intracranial pressure, they would be having and observing the pressure on the brain. So that's why the brain would not be increasing the size, and that's the reason that the patient would be mentally retarded. And as well as it is putting pressure on the cranial walled bones. So the cranial walled bone are basically getting increased pressure, and because of the increased pressure from the brain, from the due to the lack of absorption of the CSF, because of the increased pressure, the size of the cranium will be 2 or 3 times more than the normal brain. So in this example, what we have learned so far, that the size of the cranial wall is basically dependent on the growth of the brain. So if the brain growth is deficient, just like in the case of the microcephaly, they would not be having a sufficient pressure from the soft tissue, and you would be having a small size of the cranium. And the second example of the hydrocephaly, if the pressure from the brain is increased, and because of the increased intracranial pressure, the size of the cranium will be much more larger. So what is happening in this case? The size of the skeletal tissue is being determined by the soft tissue around it. So the second example the Prophet book has given is about the orbital cavity. So what happened in the orbital cavity? The size of the orbital cavity, or orbital cavity especially, I'm talking about the skeletal orbital cavity. The size of the skeletal orbital cavity is being determined by the size of the eye. If you the size of the soft tissue eye is small, then what would be happening? The size of the orbital cavity would be small. So if the size of the eye is large in the size, so what would be happening? The skeletal orbital cavity would be different in the size, and obviously it would be enlarged. So what is happening? The size of the soft tissue eye is basically determining the size of the skeletal orbital cavity. The third example the Prophet book has given is about the fracture. So what happened in the fracture of the condyle? In the fracture of the condyle, around 75 to 80% of the patient do not have any interference on the growth of the mandible. And the reason is this, that the in 75 to 80% of the patients, the function remain absolutely normal even after the fracture. What happened? You have a trauma, the incisal edge may chip off, the condyle neck may break, and the child may forget about this incident, and after some painkiller or 1 or 2 days start acting normal activity. So this theory explains in a way, if the child is practicing normal activity even after the fracture, the bone heal up. And the contemporary practice is this, that after the fracture of the especially condyle neck, they start the surgeon normally go to the early mobilization. The concept of the mobilization is actually this, that because of the early mobilization and because of the early mobility of the mandible, the growth will not be restricted. However, in the 20 to 25% of the cases in which because of the trauma, the neck has the condyle neck and condyle has positioned in such a way that it has impaired and it has restriction on the normal mobility of the mandible. So what is happening? The trauma is basically, and the breakage of the neck of the condyle is basically not the cause of the growth restriction. The cause of the growth restriction is basically the immobility and the impaired function of the mandible. So what happened in 20 to 25% of the cases of the condyle neck fracture in which you have the abnormality or facial asymmetry, actually the problem is in the mobility of the mandible. So in 20-25% of the cases which lead to development of the facial asymmetry, what happened after the breakage of the condyle neck, it just stop and restrict the condyle, may get dislodged in a way that it may interfere and stop the normal movement of the mandible. So because of the impaired movement of the mandible, you would be observing the impaired growth of the mandible on one side. However, please be aware of this, that the trauma is one of the most common reason for the facial asymmetry, and the reason is because of the restriction of the movement of the mandible rather than this. And this is according to the functional matrix theory, because the function is basically determining the shape of the bone. So if the function is impaired, the muscles around it are not functioning properly, then it will lead to the asymmetric growth of the mandible. The third example is of the ankylosis. So the ankylosis is caused by the severe infection in the temporomandibular joint, or it could be caused by the trauma and leading to hemorrhage. And because of the hemorrhage, you would be having the fusion of the condylar head with the temporal bone. So what is basically happening in the ankylosis? The mandible is not able to move forward, or the condylar head is basically not movement. Because of the restriction of the mobility of the mandible, you would be having impaired growth, and the impaired growth of the mandible because of the ankylosis is just because the muscles around the mandible are not functioning properly, and the function is basically impaired because of the ankylosis. So in the ankylosis, which is can be caused by so many reasons, so mandible function in the growing phase categorically, if it is stopped, then because of the stoppage of the functionality of the temporomandibular joint and the condylar neck, the shape of the mandible, the growth is completely being impaired, and the reason is the impairment in the functionality of the soft tissue around it. And the final example they have given about this destruction osteogenesis. In case of the destruction osteogenesis, what is happening? The bone basically start growing in response to the different changing environment. Osteogenesis means the new bone formation, and the destruction means you basically cut the bone where you need a bone growth. Even after the growth and development, you basically do the osteotomy, means you cut the bone and you gradually start distracting the bone from each other, and as a result of the inflammation, the callus formation, the bone start generating. So what is the science of the destruction osteogenesis is this, that the bone can be induced to grow at surgically created site by the method of destruction osteogenesis. And what happens is destruction osteogenesis, you basically cut the bone, and the bone is basically gradually separated from each other, and the callus formation forming the bone, and the rhythm is 0.5 to 1.5 millimeter per day. So this normally practice in the long bones, but this can be done in the orofacial region as well. And in this picture, what you can see, the bone is cut, and these are the external distractor which have been applied over here, and they are being gradually separated from each other, and the bone is being formed. So in these five examples, you have the example of the cranial wall, you have the example of the orbital cavity, you have the example of the fracture of the mandible, you have the example of the ankylosis, and the example of the destruction osteogenesis. What is happening in this destruction osteogenesis? The bone is start forming in response to the different and change environment around it. So moving on to the further discussion about the functional matrix theory. For a given particular function, all of the soft tissue around it is basically called the functional matrix, and all of the skeletal tissue associated with a particular function is basically the skeletal unit. The skeletal unit is again subdivided into two categories. They have the microskeletal unit and they have the macroskeletal unit. Obviously, the microskeletal unit merge together to form a macroskeletal. For example, taking the example of the, let's say, the mandible. So in the mandible, you have coronoid process, condylar process, angular process, alveolar process, and many other processes. So what is happening? These are the small micro units, microskeletal units. These microskeletal unit merge together to form a macroskeletal unit. So what is basically happening? You have microskeletal which merge together to form the macroskeletal unit, and the soft tissue around it, which are forming the functional matrix, are basically again divided into the periosteal matrix and divided into the capsular matrix. What is basically the periosteal matrix? Example, this is the all the muscles, blood vessels, nerve vessels and tendons around it, and the soft tissue immediately adjacent to the skeletal unit is basically the periosteal matrix, and the capsular matrix is basically the organs and the tissue spaces with a specific region. For example, in this you have the example of the neurocranium, you have the examples of the orbit, and you have the example of the oropharynx. So what is basically the capsular matrix? Capsular matrix is basically the organ and it could be a tissue space. Okay, it could be an organ and a tissue space associated with a specific region. And you have the example of the neurocranium, orbits and oropharynx. And what is the periosteal matrix? Periosteal matrix is basically the soft tissue immediately adjacent, and it is primarily and actively acting on the soft tissue. I please note the two words. It is acting directly on the bone. So what happened? Basically, the skeletal unit, which is composed of the microskeletal and which merged together to form the macroskeletal, its growth, the skeletal or the growth of the microskeletal is dependent on the growth of the and functionality of the periosteal matrix. The periosteal matrix is immediately adjacent to the microskeletal and it acts actively and directly on the microskeletal. The periosteal matrix acts directly and actively on the microskeletal, and this changes the shape of the bone. Okay, and the capsular matrix is slightly away from the direct bone, and this capsular matrix acts indirectly and passively on the bone. So you have the example of the orofacial region, orbital cavity, and the orbit, neurocranium, and the oropharynx as well. So what is basically happening? You have the growth of the soft tissue which act on the bone, and this lead to the change in the shape and the size, position, shape and morphology of the skeletal tissue, and hence the growth of the skeletal tissue is occurring secondarily and in response to the functional needs of the soft tissue around it. You have the periosteal matrix which is immediately adjacent to the bone. For example, if this is the bone, and periosteal matrix is which is immediately around the bone. Okay, and this is acting directly and actively on the bone. The capsular matrix is slightly away from the skeletal tissue. For example, in case of the brain, you don't have the brain directly in contact with the cranial walled bone. It is slightly away from them. However, the growth of the cranium is basically the determining the shape of the cranial walled bone. So what is all about the functional matrix theory is that the growth of the soft tissue is controlling the growth of the skeletal tissue. That's all.